Welcome to The Late Show on the 1st of June. Pinch a punch, the first day of the month, 2023. I am your host, Tim Vince, and today we are going to discuss DV. We're going to discuss the digital pound. And so this is a live show, it's interactive, and you can make your comments. I will go into some of the details of a consultation that was launched some time ago by the Bank of England and the His Majesty's Treasury, where they were presenting the case for the digital pound. And as I read through this consultation, aware of other government consultations over the years, which seemed to sort of draw their conclusions before the consultation has even run its course. It made me a little bit skeptical. So I thought, oh, well, I'll read it. I'll give it the benefit of the doubt and read through this epic presentation, which did look more like a sales prospectus for the digital pound than asking people for their views for the great British public. But it ends, and this is why we're discussing it today, it ends on the 7th of June. So you might be inspired after this programme to put in your two penneth, so to speak, and you know, trust that the government will take account of your concerns. It will be an interesting topic. There are some biblical passages which I believe are relevant to this subject, but why don't we start by going to the horse's mouth, so to speak, and see a presentation video which the Bank of England put together on the digital pound. And then we'll look at some of their own graphics on this subject, and I might make a few comments on it. So I'll see you soon on this subject.
The world we live in is becoming more digital. As a result, we aren't using cash as much as we used to. To keep up with the changing times, the Bank of England and HM Treasury are looking at the idea of a digital pound. This would be an electronic version of cash issued by the Bank of England and accessed through digital wallets provided by private companies. You'd be able to spend your digital pounds in the shops and online, using your phone, as well as sending them to friends and family. And you would also still be able to pay with cash or money in your bank, even if we go ahead with the digital pound. People have told us that this could be useful, but we haven't made a final decision whether to launch one. A few countries already have their own version of a digital currency, and over 100 others are thinking about it. We think the digital pound might offer a new way to pay, help businesses, build trust in money, and better protect our financial system.
So what is there not to like, that's my first question, about this wonderful, all singing, all dancing, you know, new idea, innovation in finance, in fintech? So, you know, a few scriptures do come to mind, but the first one is, you cannot serve two masters, you know, God and mammon. Put that in your pipe and smoke it. But I do also want to flag up a few warnings before we even go into the details, and you'll find them in the prophecy of Daniel. In fact, in the biblical narrative that Daniel has in the earlier chapters before he gets into the meat of his prophecies. And the first one is in Daniel 4. And I do think they're worthwhile warnings. Or was it in Daniel 3? So sorry, Daniel 3, and we'll put it up on the screen. Basically a command by Nebuchadnezzar that at the perfect time, everyone should bow down and worship King Nebuchadnezzar. I'm going to read it. Then a herald cried aloud, "To you it is commanded, O peoples, O people of Britain, O people of the English-speaking world who are watching this program, O nations and languages, that at the time you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the harp, the lyre, and the psaltery in symphony with all kinds of music." Oh, that sounds so wonderful. Oh, we must be in a really great, happy mood when we see that, or some great digital video. You shall fall down and worship the gold image that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. And whoever does not fall down and worship shall be cast immediately into the midst of a burning fiery furnace. Now, this was the first example in the Daniel accounts of the peoples being forced to worship someone other than God. And it's interesting, the context, because if you think, and we'll go through in more detail the presentation of the consultation by the Bank of England and the Treasury on the digital pound. If you look at it, it does look quite exciting. It looks quite stimulating. And as I said, what is there not to like? But I can tell you, the second half of that reading, there's everything not to like about it. There's everything for us to be alarmed about. And I want to just draw your attention to another passage in Daniel 6. Slightly different, but this time during the reign of Darius. So here we have in Daniel 6, verse 6, so these governors and satraps, you could say the civil servant of the day, thronged before the king and said thus to him, King Darius, Rishi Sunak, live forever. All the governors of the kingdom, the administrators and satraps, the counselors and advisors, so, you know, central government, local government, pretty well everyone, all the quangos, have consulted together to establish a royal statute. What could be more, you know, reliable and safe than a royal statute? To make a firm decree. Very interesting terminology. That whoever petitions any god or man for 30 days, except you, O king, and I want to hold on this screen, except you, O king, shall be cast into the den of lions. Now, this is the famous story of Daniel and the den of lions. But there's a slight difference to the Nebuchadnezzar story, and it's this. It's not only that you should bow down to worship the king, Darius, to worship the state, to worship the system. But the difference there is it says, and we need to keep it up on the screen, even though I don't mind you seeing my face and seeing, you know, me caught in the headlights, but let's just put that up again. It says that you shouldn't worship any other god. It's actually saying you cannot worship God Jehovah. So not only is it saying you must worship this deified, you know, potentate, it says very clearly it bans worship of God. Now, that's a sinister twist. And if we go to the next slates, in Daniel 6, verses 8, now, O king, establish the decree and sign the writing so that it cannot be changed according to the law of the Medes and the Persians, which does not alter. Therefore, King Darius signed the written decree. So the point about it is this. Within that passage I've just read, you have the consultation and then you have the law. And so as we study this consultation from the Bank of England, beautifully presented, oh, it's like a hard sell on a really wonderful, all singing, all dancing product. Of course, it's a product in the development, it's a prototype, but it does look as though, you know, there's quite a lot of thought, quite a lot of money has gone into packaging in a very attractive way. It's not just a little boring script. And within this consultation, because I'm quite graphically minded, there are different lovely colourful pictures which will help explain the digital pounds. So I think, of course, I must just say, before I go into this, by the way, let's do this first chart. The argument, the case for a digital currency is, look, how cash is being used less and less and less, and how digital cards, digital payments have increased to 58% from 10,000 to 25,000-ish. Cash has gone down to 15%, you know, almost an equal and opposite, an inversely proportioned decline to the increase of the use of card payments. Now, very interesting chart that was, and I can't remember what I was going to say just before. No, I know what it was. How could I have forgotten? Please text and email in if you have any thoughts on a digital pound. and digital currencies. Now, the Bank of England is at pains to say it's not like Bitcoin. It's not like a crypto currency. But when it was first presented by Rishi Sunak, who, if you remember, a long time ago, was the Chancellor of the Exchequer in 2021, during, or maybe just after the COVID era, pandemic, he was pushing for a Brit coin, which sounded very much like these other coins, these other cryptocurrencies. But ever since, the Bank of England says, no, it's not a cryptocurrency. They're very unstable. It's backed by the Bank of England. It's as sound as a pound. It's safe as the Bank of England. So there's nothing at all to worry about. Well, and they put the case. And that was, by the way, in the consultation, because I thought, well, you're not going to watch The Late Show if I just scroll through masses and masses of verbiage. And that happened to be the first slate in the consultation paper, putting the case for a digital currency. It would be good to go through more. I need to know that you haven't all tuned out and are watching some preview for the FA Cup final. But I'm going to go through this consultation because I think it is interesting. And by the way, if you watch that video, you will see in the map that they showed of the world, the different areas, the early adopters of a digital currency. And surprise, surprise, one of the very first to sort of develop this technology is, guess what, who? China. So when I think of dictatorships, autocracy, you know, tyrant nations, I do think of the Communist Party in China. So I'm not sure how reassuring it is to say that they have developed this technology. And the point there is that it's a very oppressive surveillance state. And however benign the Bank of England present a digital currency, you have to say, as a citizen, would you want to be in a situation where you have, you know, significant controls that they're at pains to say that they won't be there with this digital currency. But what happens if the keys, as it were, are passed to someone else, someone more menacing and less benign and more malign in intent? So we're talking about the digital pound today, the 1st of June, 2023. And I'm looking forward to hearing your comments. Myra has come in. And said, as one who was teaching 6 to 7 year olds when a digital coinage came about, I thought I'd put in my 2 pennies. At that time, we were asked to teach the old and new coinage together. And this was not as straightforward as one might think. And by the way, I remember digitization as well in 1972. I also remember that at that time, my mother-in-law's reaction to the new coinage. When shopping, she would say wistfully to the shopkeepers, "And what is that in real money, please?" I came to terms with it myself, but strangely, when told at the time of some appointment or occasion, I continue starting to count on from 12 noon as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yes, of course, they changed even the clocks to become more 24-hour. I look forward to seeing what you include in this program. As to money today, I continue to buy everything online, so rarely have any cash or paper money in my purse, just a debit card. Every blessing. Thank you very much, Myra. I'm actually quite similar on that front. We'll dig more into it, and folks might have comments about credit cards and cash. I also have here a text from Paul and Ruth. Tim, regarding the digital pound, we are being forced to adhere to the internet and mobile banking. That's almost answering Myra without even knowing what I was about to read. Not everyone wants to use this system. It does not cater for everyone. It is a reward without value on anything solid. Bless you. That's from Paul and Ruth. And by the way, in their title line, they have put Revelation 13, verse 16, which we might come on to a bit later. Hi, Tim. This is from Laura. I'm not quite sure how the digital pound would work. Would it be much different from paying contactless? You're not actually handling your money, but as long as there is funds in the bank, then it's okay. I'm not sure why people think it's such a bad idea. I myself prefer cash in my purse and paying by cash in shops. I tend to keep to more of a budget when I do this, but I do like ordering online. Well, the first thing is, Laura, with this digital pound, is you won't be charged interest, but they will have intermediaries, private providers, who will maybe, I don't know what the rules will be because they haven't set it up yet, but who may take a cut if they're dealing with your transactions, I don't know. But if, as they are presenting it, that it's identical to the value of, as it were, what, you know, that former prime minister said, whose name escapes me, the pound in your pocket isn't worth any less, Harold Wilson. The point is, let's see as it unfolds. I'll read one more text and then I'll look at some of the graphics from the consultation paper. And by the way, you're in this free country of ours, you can go into the Bank of England website and look up digital pound consultation. And this final one is from Anonymous. It's an easy step towards the cashless world, and they take control of all your money. Let's have a look at some of the graphics. Thank you, by the way, for all of those early emails and texts. This is a debate, isn't it? Now, this is an interesting one. Now, this was the last of the slates, but during the consultation paper, they highlighted different ones. They started with those first three on the left. You know, it's going to be a partnership with the Bank of England and the public, and call it a public-private partnership, because private companies have to develop the fintech for it to work. And then public digital money, going down on the left, will be issued by a central platform operated by the Bank of England. All sounds very safe. And then you'll have a digital wallet to hold the digital pounds offered by the private sector. That's probably worth just stopping there and going on to the next slide, and just to dig in a bit more. This is easy to read. It's talking about what are the primary motivations for them issuing the digital pound. In one sense, you could say they're putting the case for this new gizmo. Ensuring the role of UK central bank money as an anchor for confidence and safety in a monetary system. Well, I mentioned cryptocurrencies, and that's one of their central arguments. We've got to tie this whole industry down. Sustaining access to financially risk-free central bank money as the anchor of monetary and financial stability. Could I make a comment on that first, and then we'll come back to this slide? And that is that the governor of the Bank of England, Mervyn King, the former governor, the present governor is Andrew Bailey, but the former governor said in at the time when Rishi Sunak launched the idea, he really questioned what whether there was anything new in what was being proposed, and also what the actual benefits in terms of security would be. And it's interesting, they're making it a central argument that you would have the security of your money because it's issued by the Bank of England. But that shouldn't change what is on your £5 and £10 and, you know, £50, £20 and £50 notes, which says, I promise to pay the bearer. That's as secure as the Bank of England. But if we go to this slate again, there's the second column, which just gives a little more interesting description. So they it looks very attractive. Promoting innovation. We just wonder, how can you innovate a banknote, as it were? But you innovate and you increase choice and efficiency. You promote innovation, choice and efficiency in payments as our payment habits and economy become more digital. Well, that's what they're setting up as their attraction or motivation for the digital pound. I sort of dug into this because most of it's pretty boring stuff, and you would say, well, what is different from the credit cards or the debit cards that Myra mentions? And I'd like to have a look at another slate, if I may. Don't don't tune, as Yemi would say, don't touch that dial. Have a look at this next slate, because I found it quite interesting looking into the detail of what is there that is innovative and new. What's the potential within the digital pound? I don't know whether we have it queued up to come on the screen. It wasn't that one, it was another one, but we could. This was the one that really interested me because it talks about and then describes underneath, you know, examples of principles for payments for the PIP. This is the independent payment interface providers. And the two that really caught my eye were the one on the top right, which is inclusion. And I have to say, whenever I've lived a few years through this, using this and hearing this term inclusion and inclusivity, and often I found in my experience that it can mean the absolute opposites. They include those who they want to be included, and you know, I've often found that those of a faith position such as us might not be taken into account. And then on one level, you could say, well, it seems absolutely fair enough. If people are, as they say, digitally excluded, let's say disabled folk who can't use a digital device, or the elderly, you know, my mum, you know, you've always got to bring your mum into a program, but you know, we set her up with a wonderful iPad, but it doesn't matter how many, as it were, templates you'd set the whole thing up for her, it just wasn't her thing. And so the question is, and the challenge for the Bank of England, this is on one of their other slates, is how can you make a digital currency, a digital pound, as accessible as the paper printed money? And that is a very important question. But they're saying, well, this is all part of the innovation of the digital pound, but it does seem a backward step if not everyone can use it. And then they used another term, which sort of made me wonder what they were saying when they talked about diversity. And again, if they're just, and that was the third one on the bottom line. And of course, they write below, offer products and services that meet, evolve with, and respond to societal changes and needs. I'd be very interested to know what they mean by that, but maybe I'm just a little bit sceptical. I'll read a few more of your wonderful texts. In fact, they've been burgeoning since I started this subject. Next one. I have a Turkish cafe here in Wales who still don't take cards, only cash. That's from Dory. Thank you, Dory. Next one. This is more control. We must listen to the Holy Spirit and be led by him and him alone, Mark says. Dave says, from what I can see, digital money has only one advantage. No one could bop you over the head and steal it, as they wouldn't know your entry PIN codes. I don't know whether you've ever heard of people being marched to cash machines or even on their phones being told to look into the facial recognition and then told to enter their codes when they're being threatened. Anyway, sorry, Dave. It's always a good email if I interrupt it halfway through reading it. I don't know whether you know it, but according to the news on the TV the other day, more people have been using cash just lately. That's true. And by the way, following up your earlier point, there's been a lot more theft as well because there's a cost of living crisis. This is from Adam. Sadly, this is all part of a global scheme that will allow for control of populations. God help us. This is the time for the church to wake up, as difficult times are ahead. But reading from Daniel 12, those who are wise will shine like the brightness of the heavens, and those who lead many to righteousness like the stars forever and ever. Thank you very much for that, Adam. Next one. Thank you, by the way, for emailing in. It's wonderful. By the way, this is very similar to last week's Late Show where I was talking about empires. I've just drilled into one aspect of what is menacing about, you know, government control when it goes wrong. the point is, you know, for all the problems we have in our society, we do still have freedoms that were bequeathed to us through the Judeo-Christian heritage, and we should hold on to them fiercely by God's grace. Pray for his mercy, you know, pray for him to stay his hand of judgment on our nation, not only for our sakes, but for the sakes of the children and the grandchildren, because there's like a whirlwind coming on a number of social, cultural and financial levels. Let's chat on WhatsApp. I don't know who that is. That's just found its way in. That's a rogue message from China, I think. Shalom, Tim. This is from Margaret in Ayrshire. I have absolutely not tuned out. This is really interesting and helpful. The Daniel scriptures particularly, the Lord knows, will be paying attention throughout the program. Thank you very much, Margaret. Yeah, I do think this, the issue about the law of the Medes and the Persians and being assured that they will follow the laws. Well, I'm afraid we've seen just since David Cameron and his promises to reflect the family in the tax system, that they promise laws in their manifestos and they don't enact them. And then laws which are distinctly missing from manifestos, and for instance, the coalition agreement between the Lib Dems and the Conservatives in 2010, never mentioned another law which they brought in by stealth and never asked the people about it. And whenever you have laws that are passed by Parliament, often waved through on, let's say, the 40-day rule, as they call it, where they're literally rubber stamped and washed, rushed through Parliament, you have to be suspicious about such laws. And by the way, the relationships and sex education guidance for schools was one such law. Oh, don't worry, it's just a guidance. Oh, don't worry, we're just thinking about doing a digital pound. When they say don't worry, that's when you have to, you know, literally, you know, the alarm bells should ring. I'm not being overly cynical, I hope. It's from bitter experience of studying what governments do, and especially what gets pushed through by the civil service. This is from Debbie. I tend to pay mostly online, but keep around £20 on me for taxis near local stations, as that is their preferred method of payment. By the way, I always have to find this pound coin, you know, to go when we go to a Lidl or Aldi. And also sometimes when you park, they only take cash. And I once spent about half an hour going around banks trying to get hold of change for a £5 note. And because of money laundering rules, there were no banks that were prepared to actually change this money. So I'm desperate to get that pound coin in the payment machine before I get slapped a £50 fine for parking. Anyway, Debbie, you carry on. Again, I've interrupted your email. We really need to be careful of this digital money. They start with it's okay, but with everything else, it changes as we get used to it within society. That's the thing, mission creep. You'll need, Pauline, you'll need to send another text because there's nothing, there's no text in this one. I have one from Gillian. I can't read it all out because of the rules of broadcasting, but the EU have recently made a new coin with a unicorn on it. I watched the video last night, which was in the US, about unsustainable debt. That's another very important law. And by the way, oh yes, oh, it's safe as the Bank of England, you know, it's as sound as a pound, but not if the economy collapses, then people rush through all sorts of strange changes. And you're saying they're setting up new loans for certain groups. So whether they are going to stop us from borrowing or not, the mind boggles. That's from Gillian. Yeah, I think the worst case scenario in a digitally controlled currency, not just currency, but unit of currency, the pound, is that they could dictate, which I'm sure they're thinking about in China and possibly Russia, who are trying to take over some of the, or do a deal for Chinese, you know, AI technology and surveillance technology, is they will control when you spend your money. They will control how, who you pay with your money. They could even set an expiry date on the money itself. So they could say, for instance, you can't give to Revelation TV, that dodgy outfit. They believe in the Bible. That opposes the zeitgeist of our time, which is the secular, humanist, atheist, communist worldview. They could easily go down that route. And let's, you know, be watchful, you know, as we pray, and be aware of what is happening in the world today, because, you know, we are not anymore one, you know, hermetically sealed little island, you know, off the coast of Europe. We're all interconnected. In fact, the UK is very much at the forefront of fintech, so much so that Rishi Sunak, we were reading in today's paper, is petitioning Joe Biden that the UK could become the world centre for the regulation of AI, because we're so advanced in fintech and other areas. Well, I'd be careful what you wish for, Rishi. The wonderful digital pound is the death knell of our freedom. This is an anonymous text. Totalitarian control will follow. I filled in the online petition to say to each, I strongly disagree with CBDC proposals in their entirety. No to the digital pound. We have a perfectly valid currency. There's no good reason to change it again. Thank you, Anon, for that. Hi, Tim. This is from Sharon. I'm 71 years old, and it scares me to think that all our access to our finances will be controlled by money we cannot hold in our hands. Well, of course, Sharon, they'll say, well, it will stop illegal, illicit money. It will stop all of the, you know, these people trading if it became a worldwide currency. Oh, that's an interesting terminology, global. A global digital currency that can stop the people traffickers, can stop the mafia trading, can stop the drug smuggling. Oh, all these wonderful ways that you could prevent things. Now, of course, the governments are saying, I'll read some more of these wonderful texts, but the government are saying, of course, we won't be sharing any data. It's going to be absolutely, we're going to have a very good regulation of how data is shared. Well, you say that to Boris Johnson, or you say it to the person who has managed to produce to Julian Assange and WikiLeaks, or to Edward Snowden, you know, and to those who leak the Panama Papers. The fact is, everything gets leaked as soon as it's in a digital form. Someone can sort of sidle away out of the Bank of England with a digital chip in their pocket, and they're gone, or just press one button and go, oops, and it goes to the media. I doubt very much that the controls that they say they can have on the data protection will be foolproof. Time will tell. But that's a very important point that you make, Sharon. This is Anita. Lovely to see you. I hope Ben is doing well. Thank you. Anita, you always ask about my dear brother Ben, and we just would say, keep praying. Keep praying for Ben. He's going to have another operation. And, you know, if I said one thing on this program, it is please pray for my brother Ben. As to the digital currency, Anita says, it's just another form of control. As you've told us before, the banks own our money. Many people I know are paid in cash now, and the government can't control that. Most taxi drivers and tradespeople are still paid in cash, but even the bigger taxi firms are taking cards now. That's true. Whilst, by the way, a lot of taxi drivers have been forced out of business by some of these online, you know, taxi providers who have been encouraged in big cities. Now, whilst the government have said that the digital pound will help international payments, it could change the structure of the financial system and make us more open to foreign shocks. Interesting, very interesting point. You know, the pound is not the only currency, if you may have noticed, on foreign exchange markets, and we're floating around with all sorts of other, you know, fiat currencies, and it does look pretty unstable to me. When you think that the pound against the dollar was once $2.2 to the pound, and it's now, you know, floating around 1.24-ish, that's a big change. That's always going to carry on, unless they say, well, why are we bothering with exchanging currencies? Why don't we just have one? What a good idea. Oh, how efficient is that? Yeah, why don't we just have one world ruler? That would be so efficient. We don't have to bother with committees and, you know, PR. You just have one ruler who says, this is what you're going to do. Do it. Oh, where have I read that? We might read about that later. A very interesting programme from Clarissa. 2 points. Firstly, that since our money is no longer linked to the gold reserve, it depends totally. See, I just mentioned, it's always funny when emails come in just after I've mentioned, say, fiat currencies, you know, when we went off the gold standard and started printing money. But anyway, since our money is no longer linked to the gold reserve, it depends totally on the confidence of the public, which of course can be lost in an instant. Credit crunch comes to mind. Secondly, and by the way, it's all based on trust. So trust me, you know, I'm the governor of the Bank of England. Really? And then trust me, I'm the Chancellor of the Exchequer. Secondly, Clarissa says, it is already difficult to teach small children about money since they hardly ever see coins being used. Yeah, and do they know the value of money? Or as the former chief rabbi Jonathan Sacks says, we know the price of everything and the value of nothing. From Alan, digital currency is similar to how financial transactions take place at the moment. The significance of digital currency is the fact that, like store cards, it can be used to track your spending. Now to the younger generation, this is good because they can get offers on similar products they purchase. The sinister aspect is a form of control. By the way, on this issue of children, because one of the arguments that was made a couple of years ago was, we can stop children buying unhealthy sweeties and things like that. So isn't that a wonderful thing? Because you can control the currency. Interesting point. I'm sure the Bank of England is listening to this program and will certainly, God willing, take account of any submissions you make before the end of the consultation, which is the 7th of June. We've got less than a week. Now to the younger generation, you've said that. The sinister aspect is a form of control. It is a simple matter to take the next step and have programmable digital currency. You're absolutely right, Alan. They can then freeze accounts when trying to purchase something that an unknown group say is no longer available. China is an example of this. Thank you very much, Alan, because that reinforces, that's Alan from Bridgend, reinforces what I've been saying. Tim, I think this is all about control and we should resist the digital currency at all costs. Use cash whenever you can, from Thomas. Thank you very much, Thomas. And from Sharon again, I think, it may be another Sharon. Thanks for this subject. It all seems so wonderful, but all it's doing is taking away our freedom and controlling us in every way. Frightening. Barry Smith did warn us, and 20 years ago, I thought it was impossible. He did warn us. He's remarkably close to what we are moving towards now, which is a cashless society. It seems so logical. Look, it's down to 15% now of all transactions. You know, why not just get rid of cash altogether? Tell that to my barber. The records of how we spend our money, for example, bank statements, credit card bills, give a clear picture of how we live our lives. Conversely, control of our money can lead to more control of our lives. I agree that alarm bells are ringing with digital money. Thanks, Tim, for an interesting and informative programme. And thank you very much. That's so nice, Brian, for you to write in. And here we have, hi, Tim, from Kate, or Katie. It's not the digital currency I'm worried about. It's the social credit system that will be brought in by the back door. What's happening in China in regards to this system should be a wake-up call to the church that they, the powers that be, want to control morality and to be the deciders, the arbiters of what is right and wrong in society's viewpoint, replacing God as the moral guideline. That's very, very pertinent, Kate. I have Christian friends in China, some of whom have been imprisoned just for possessing foreign religious literature. And how can you get such literature to them in the future and to others, many others who are going underground to carry on with Christian education? Very, very difficult when they've closed the borders, they've closed the transactions, and they've closed the whole, you know, digital world. This is from Marilyn. So sorry, I always look at the. I'm so sorry, Marilyn, because you say at the top line, please don't read my name out. So out of respect to you, I won't read the email, and apologies again. I normally read the bottom of the email first, just to see who's written. This is from Pauline. We have heard so much about digital currency, and glad you're going to explain it more fully as you do in Bible study. We have spent 20 years in Ireland, but English born and bred, and have a family there, though being part of the EU. Now, I'm sure things will be just as bad, if not worse. Thanks for your honest opinions. We're in the sort of the third quartile of the programme, if the two things make sense. And so let's just have a look at a couple more graphics from this wonderful All Singing, All Dancing consultation promotional leaflets. This is saying, what are their objects for the digital pound? Neither the government nor the bank would have access to digital pound users' personal details. They'll probably say that a bit later on, that it's the private providers who have your personal data. But anyway, a digital pound would not be anonymous because the ability to identify and verify users is needed to prevent financial crime. This is the argument we mentioned earlier. Sounds very benign, in fact, very positive. Third one in the middle, users should be able to choose from a range of wallet services. Varying levels of identification would be accepted. Another interesting detail there. Users, the fourth one, should be able to vary their privacy preferences to suit their needs. What we'll probably find from that is that you won't be able to use it unless you disclose, you know, a wider selection of, whether you lift the lid on your privacy settings. And then the final one, enhanced privacy functionality could result in digital pound users securing greater benefits from sharing their personal data. So they've gone around full circle from saying your data will be protected to basically saying, you know, you'll be encouraged to share as much personal data as possible. Thank you very much for that one. Is there another slide? Let's see if we can get through these slides and then I'll read more. This is the one that I didn't go through earlier, but it does just give you an insight into how the financial system works. And they're saying, look, it'd be no different with a digital currency. So when you have, you know, those three blocks at the top, you have the wholesale central bank money, and you have cash, which is from that. They're showing how you use the cash, and it all works within a robust regulatory framework. It all works until it doesn't work. Risk-free public money. Yep, they want to allay any fears that there'll be any risks. Uniformity, that's an interesting word. Trust in money and the financial system. This is how it all works. These are the pillars. And then you get monetary stability and financial stability. Of course, it looks reassuring until you get a run on the banks, so to speak. And in fact, the way to get around a run on the banks is just to have a digital currency and don't worry about the banks. In fact, banks will then just become facilitators, agents of the government. Next is from Paul and Ruth again. Dear Tim, we're responsible for the banking crisis, yet they still award bonuses to bank staff and deny the Bank of England was responsible for the banking crisis. Yet they still award bonuses to bank staff and deny responsibility, Northern Rock, etc. What a hoot. Thank you very much. Now, the point about this banking crisis is they were desperate to keep those banks alive. And Mervyn King at the time, I met him actually at a breakfast in the city, right at the height of the cost of living, not the cost of living, you know, the credit crunch crisis in 2008. And he said, we've moved into a territory of moral jeopardy because banks have become too big to fail. By that meaning that the government must give the banks more money to prop them up. They can't allow the banks to fail. So that encourages them to waste more money, to pay higher salaries and higher bonuses because they're going to be bailed out by the government anyway because they're too big to fail. It's an absolute moral jeopardy. And I had great respect for Mervyn King. And by the way, so did the city, and so did the international markets. And whenever he spoke and gave his updates from the Monetary Policy Committee, you know, generally the markets went up in response. And one has to say with Andrew Bailey, the current governor of the Bank of England, he doesn't instill the same level of confidence. But he may be completely competent in his job, but there's just certain things he says which don't give the instill confidence. He looks worried, he's often sweating, and I wish him well personally, but as governor of the Bank of England, it doesn't instill confidence. Just my opinion. There may be other opinions out there, and by the way, there are. because I'm getting dozens of emails and texts on this subject. Myra says, I am now 87, so shall not have too long to wait and see what all this stuff leads to. Have appreciated the programme, thank you. Whatever our opinions on this, I guess it is unavoidable anyway. Well, that is really the key point about this consultation. It seems as though there's an inevitability about this march, this gathering rush towards a worldwide digital currency. And then Amira just says how much she appreciates the politics programme. I'll definitely mention that to Simon. It made me think about the subjects of abortion as I did not know where I stood on the subject as a Christian. I still don't know where I stand, though, I know where I ought to stand. Thank you, Myra. I think we're all here to learn from each other. And I do believe that, you know, if you read God's word and you watch and pray, you'll be better placed for whatever is coming on us. And by the way, it's accelerating and the change is exponential. We've never lived in a time like it. We might have been in the sort of early stages at the beginning of the 20th century and then some of the terrible events of the last century, but now it just seems to be going through the roof. And of course, AI is a connected issue here, because it's not just some Chinese dictator taking over all of our data and details. AI, you know, is being teed up to become a very powerful force in our world. What you said about governments controlling money and not letting you donate to EG Revelation TV, simply buy some gold jewelry, give it to Rev TV, they sell it at the donation. Completes. That's simple, says Dave. How do you convert it into the digital pound? It'd be an interesting exercise. Hello, Tim. Just started watching. I prefer to use cash. This is from Les. But I notice sometimes shops have refused to accept cash, and sometimes at the self-service in bigger shops, when no humans are on duty at the tills, all the machines are card only. Absolutely. Tim, please remind your viewers about how the Canadian government froze the accounts of individuals who donated to the truckers last year. Thank you from Stuart. Wasn't that amazing? Wasn't that amazing? I remember when Christian Voice was closed down by the co-op, by that meths, they called him the meths preacher, because he used to take crystal meths, and he was the chair of the company, and it was virtue signaling. But because of the strident biblical views of Christian Voice, they shut down their accounts. And by the way, they're not the only Christian ministry who've had their accounts shut down. But here we have, as Stuart mentions, the Canadian government freezing those who are not, it didn't fit in with the politically correct viewpoint of the government. And by the way, based a lot of it, and it was during the COVID time, based on the science and the experts of the day, whereas now, you know, other stuff is coming out, which means that at the very least, there should be a little bit more humility by governments and a little less heavy-handedness. In fact, the opposite of what is being promised with these type of, you know, financial controls. And even a scientist, one of the chief scientists in China, is saying that the bug came out of a lab, or the possibility that it came out of a lab in Wuhan. That would be unheard of a couple of years ago. You wouldn't get very far in the West if you said that. Tim, watching you live right now, we didn't switch over for the football because this is serious. Thank you. I agree. That's from Andy. I have worked in IT since 1995, and I totally agree with everything you've said. This is all a plan to stop access to money, and the acceleration of AI is all controlled by those in control. Thank you for this great effort of yours. Totally on board with the messaging to those reading this. Thank you very much, Andy. I'm glad you mentioned AI. I can give a plug for On Demand. Howard and Cy were actually experimenting, as it were, with, you know, AI apps in The Late Show yesterday on the 31st of May. So you might want to tap in to that. And Marilyn just writes this. Thank you, Marilyn. Some places you can't even park your car without a smartphone. And some of my friends who have these not-so-smartphones activate their phones with a thumbprint. What if you cut or damage your thumb? You're cut out of the digital system. Ah, thanks for the show. Oh boy, have I had problems parking. I could tell, I could do a whole program on parking your car, Marilyn. I've told you the one about trying to find a pound coin for love nor money and not managing it. Not that I gave much love, but in the end, I discovered how absolutely inflexible the whole system is and you have to comply. Well, we could talk so much about those private parking, you know, Taliban controllers who are out to get you in on the small print, even if you're shopping on a car park. It's private land, you know, the law says that you know, if they put a public notice up, even if you can't read it, you have to pay the fine. This is from Brian. They are already controlling how much cash you can withdraw from your accounts. Who can say that this might change to zero? I must say how difficult it was. You know, during the recent crises, going to a bank and trying to take money out was quite difficult. And by the way, quite difficult to put money in. The controls are unbelievable. And you can understand to an extent, we can always put on our reasonable hat and say, well, you do have to stop criminality and you do have to stop illicit money. And where did that money come from? Where did that £5 note come from, Tim Vince? You know, you look a bit suspicious to me. I've seen your passport photo. And this is from Jean. Very interesting what you're explaining about in regards to the digital pound. We would have to share private various answers for identification purposes. In fact, in that, I find that to be worrying because who is getting access to this information on us? It's all leading to whoever doesn't have the mark won't be able to buy or sell. Okay, let's show the slate from Revelation. It's an echo of what we read from Daniel. Okay, so we had the worship of Nebuchadnezzar, we had the worship of Darius, we had the forbidding of worship of God. And now in Revelation 13, he causes all, both small and great, rich and poor, free and slave, to receive a mark on their right hand or on their foreheads, and that no one may buy or sell except one who has the mark or name of the beast or the number of his name. Now, I'm not saying that the digital pound is the beast or that it is, you know, we this is it, as it were. But it certainly does seem to be, you know, consider the fig tree and all the trees. You know, when you see it put forth its leaves, you know that summer is near. There are things happening. And it's not just one. It's a whole combination of things that are happening that should make any Christian alarmed. And of course, money is neutral. But what money is used for, how money is worshipped, how money can be used to manipulate people into not worshipping God. And this is the environment, the culture in which these technological proposals are being put forwards. This now is from, this is actually on the same job. Interesting, this is a text on the same subject that we've just read on. Sadly, we can see the mark of the beast on the horizon. Bear in mind, no one can buy and sell. Amazing. And also earlier in that passage, it talks about a formidable, powerful military force. Those things are getting to a stage now where you can imagine men's hearts will grow faint with fear, as the Lord Jesus said, for what is coming on the earth. The digital pound is the forerunner. It is one of the forerunners of the mark. But thank God, people seem to be awake and aware of the dangers of the digital pound. They will control what we can buy and how much we can spend and control what we sell. We pretty soon will not be able to buy or sell without taking the mark. Fred writes, thanks for your presentation on digital pound. It appears to explain why so many banks are closing. I take it pensions will be paid into one's accounts as at present. Also, how will direct debits be paid? I also feel there is a danger that the proposed digital pound will result in more people overspending and ending in debt. Well, who will be in control then? What are your thoughts? I agree with every point you make. So anything that requires a transaction could go through this funnel. And the question is it just a means of exchange, a means of transaction, or is there within that means of transaction a monitoring, a control of how you spend, what you spend on, when you spend, who you give to? I think these are valid questions which we have a right to ask. This is our inheritance. You know, think of Naboth. Do we just say, okay, let's, for the sake of having a quiet life, for the sake of having a another vineyard or some other, you know, bauble in this modern, you know, consumer world, we'll sell the inheritance of our fathers. Well, I think it's a spiritual inheritance, and we should hold on to it. The inheritance that's been bequeathed through blood, toil, tears, and sweat, so that we don't end up in a situation where we become slaves to a system. And I know we're getting close to the end of the program. I'd like to read what is a very special passage on freedom. And when the Lord Jesus was there in Nazareth, he opened the scroll, if you remember, in the synagogue, and he read a wonderful section which was he was reading directly from Isaiah 61. And read this with me together. It's in Luke 4, verse 18. The Lord said this when he opened the scroll. The Spirit of the Lord is upon me because he has anointed me to preach the gospel to the poor. He has sent me to heal the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty, to proclaim freedom to the captives. It is for freedom that Christ has set us free, in Galatians chapter 5, verse 1. Sorry, I digress, as I do through emails, onto other scripture passages. But let's just read to the end of that passage in Luke 4. To proclaim liberty to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, to set at liberty those who are oppressed. This is the commission. So isn't that a wonderful mandate that we have from the Lord Jesus? We're not talking about a bank mandate where you have to sign a check. We're talking about a mandate to preach the gospel, the true word of God, which will endure long after all these currencies and flim-flam come to an end. Thank you so much for all of your texts and emails. Thank you, Lord, for your scriptures to guide us. And let's watch and pray in this generation, and always remember to give glory and thanks to the Lord in your life.